Today, we honor the fathers of the first six ecumenical councils, but I have to say that if you want to put a priest or bishop to silence, just ask them to explain to you the teachings of the fifth and sixth council. They're important, but you know, in the scheme of things, I was looking at the saints of the week, you know, the feast of the given to us today, the fathers of the council, the readings that are given to us, and one that really hit me in the theological richness that we have is in fact the reading from St. Paul in the chapter 12 of Romans, which is in your bulletin. And the reason why is that, if you think about it, after Pascha, we have this feast, and then we have a preparation for Pentecost. And after Pascha, we read from the book of Acts of the Apostles. And then we roll into Romans, the next book. We also read the Gospel of John, then we roll back into Matthew. And we don't pay attention because I think with the epistle, there's assignments every day. So you come on Sunday and you get Romans chapter 1, but the next week is Romans chapter 5, and then it's Romans chapter 8, and then it's chapter 12, and we get these little bits and pieces of the beautiful teachings that we should be, of course, pursuing one chapter, one verse at a time. And so now we reach chapter 12 of Romans, we're almost at the end of this great book. And I'm not sure if you've ever done this. I'm not sure that I have. I think I should. Is to sit down and to read all of Romans in one sit-down reading. It would take, I have to look at Kindle, it would tell me how long it would take, right, to read this. It would probably take 2 hours to read what is truly a theological masterpiece. And every chapter builds from chapter 1 about creation and the fall to the grace of God, to the revelation of faith, of the role of Israel. It's incredibly rich and sometimes overwhelming. And then you reach the conclusion almost of the book and it becomes what it really is all about, which is the theology and the disputes. It's about the Christian life. And it's very specific, the advice given to the Romans. Now, I think that the advice given to the Church of the Romans is as powerful and needful today as it was when St. Paul gave that scroll to someone to run it to the Romans. I happen to be watching the weekly religious news, and it was about the happenings in the Church of Rome. And I thought, wow, things haven't changed very much. The needs, the problems, the disputes. Today, last week, as 2,000 years ago. But then St. Paul wrote to the Corinthians, right? Corinth in Greece. And I had in my Orthodox News of the Week this headline, Greeks are suddenly worshipping ancient Greek gods all over again. So you see, the epistles that the Spirit gave to us through the apostles are as alive and powerful and current today as they ever were. I remember our dean, now Bishop Michael of New York, said that he was invited to give a retreat at a Greek Orthodox church somewhere in the USA. And he is of Slavic descent, but he enters into the office of the secretary, and there's all the statues of the Greek gods in some kind of a museum type of display. And he says, tongue in cheek, what are these things here? And she answers, they are gods. And he just told the story as, well, we're still dealing with some issues, I mean, all of us in different ways. But so here we have the climax of theology of St. Paul to the Romans, and it ends with a simple gospel teaching. You might as well hear the parable of the talents. You have gifts from God. What are they? Use them. Be generous with the gifts that God has given you. Then he says, love from the heart. Don't be hypocrites. You might as well read the teachings of the Lord Jesus with the Pharisees. And to forgive from the heart. And then he says, which is a verb that we never use, I think, in modern English. Abhor. Be horrified. Be disgusted by what is evil. But that is difficult to do. I think in our culture, to express any kind of disgust for evil is difficult to do. You know, we've been trained to really accept so much. But he says, abhor what is evil and cling to what is good. I wonder if we're able to do this at this point in our culture, our upbringing, to basically, you know, look at a selection of movies for the evening and say, that's good and that's evil. Or that's worthless, which for St. Paul is in the same box as evil. It's hard to do because everything now is a mixture. While we have to accept a lot of evil to enjoy some of the entertainment, it's difficult for Christians to live by that verse. But then he talks about some things that are very practical to a small parish as we are. He says, be kindly affectionate. Be kindly affectionate. Or as Donald will say, I would like a hug. Right? It's true. You could cite Romans chapter 12 any time you want, right? Be kindly affectionate to one another. Almost every Sunday, not quite, comes time for the kiss of peace, and I often think, why in the world don't we do it? Roman Catholics do it. It's not a kiss of peace, it's a handshake, and it's, you know, it can sometimes turn into something a bit out of control. But the Coptic Christians do it, they have a way, they do their little handshake like this. Many parishes do the kiss of peace. It's an apostolic tradition. Why can't we do it? I'll let you circulate the petition, and when you have signatures, bring it to me, and we'll do the kiss of peace. If we claim to be apostolic, to obey the traditions, why don't we do it? Why don't we lift up our hands, kneel when it's proper time, and give the kiss of peace? I think it's something to think about. To think about. If there's 2,000 people, it may not be possible, so there's wisdom sometimes to think about it. But I think sometimes we want to go and express that love. Because we kiss icons, because we kiss, first of all, the saints, the living saints among us. We don't want to disconnect these two things. Then he says, be given to hospitality. When the students come once a year from HSU, I tell them, if you want to understand Christianity in its biblical form, in its oriental, eastern form, just look at that icon over there. It's the icon of Orthodoxy. It's the so-called Trinity, which it isn't the Trinity, right? It's the hospitality of Abraham. It's that quintessential biblical moment where Abraham, the righteous, the father of our faith, sees strangers. He's comfortable under his trees, the strangers in the heat. He runs to them, he kneels, he bows down to them, he calls them Lord. He says, come, I beg you, and have a meal with me. And in that moment, he receives the very presence of God. The promise that will make him the father of the faithful. When people die and go to paradise, they go to Abraham's bosom because the one quality which he had, he was hospitable. And that is the essential quality of that culture, to be hospitable. And it's difficult to do so. But to be a community, we need to be hospitable to make that effort. St. Paul says, be given to hospitality. Sometimes, even Irene tells me, you know, we're overwhelmed, but she's given. She said, well, this week we need to have someone. So I say, let's work on that. Let's work as a parish, to be hospitable, to be given-driven, to be compulsively hospitable in whatever way that we can, that we may be a community. And I really more and more believe in this idea that we need to have community, that the gospel takes people out of the world and brings them together, right? Ecclesia, taken out, to come together, to be glued into, it's like the prosphora bread, right? To get the grains are glued into a single body by the power and grace of the Spirit. And I think we love this idea of fellowship. I wonder sometimes, why do people like so much this book, Lord of the Rings? Well, volume one, if you know the book or seen the movies, it's called The Fellowship of the Ring. I think people resonate with that. There's dwarves, and there's elves with long ears, there's tiny people with furry feet. Doesn't matter what you look like, really, but you're together on a quest that is good. And I think we need this. This is what the church is about. It's a community. And the proof of the gospel is in the pudding, so to speak. It's in the affection, the hospitality, the support that must exist. And it's true in the gospel today. You know, we notice sometimes, and we can notice today, it's people bring the paralytic to Jesus. It's a community, perhaps four men. Maybe neighbors, maybe relatives, but the man has to be brought by community to Jesus, and he sees their faith. And so, yes, there's my faith and there's your faith, but does Christ see our faith as a communal reality expressed in all these things? And so I would give some practical advice. One is, let us determine to be hospitable and to be committed to the community here. And I would say this, let us choose this community and not any. You know, some people are involved in the Kiwanis and whatever else is, you know, things like that. This is the community given to us by God. This is the one that He established. This is the one that gives us true love, true meaning, eternal power. And I think that being scattered is not good. Let us commit to this community of faith, to this Eucharistic gathering. And it's here not about, you know, being like in Romans, a Jew or a Greek or of any background. You know, the identity that we have here is in Christ. And I sometimes get concerned about how we identify ourselves in anything else but Christ. More and more people have these labels, political labels, very destructive for communities. Even, you know, ethnic, national labels. But our citizenship is in heaven, and our hope is certainly not in princes, in sons of men, in whom there is no salvation, as we sing every Sunday. So feel encouraged to invite each other. Feel free to invite me for lunch. I know there's now a lot of us. It's difficult to invite four kids, sorry. But feel free to invite me. I welcome that. And to really build this bond of affection, of care for the needs of the parish. To be concerned. I haven't seen this person for a few weeks. Am I praying for this person? Am I reaching out? Sometimes the priest can't do everything when it comes to, maybe there's a reason why I can't be effective, maybe you can't be effective by reaching out to people that are perhaps in need. So may we experience even here and now the blessedness of life given to us by Christ, filled with love and affection and forgiveness, the glory of God the Father who saves us, who calls us to life in Christ Jesus, by the power of the Holy Spirit, now and ever, and to the ages of ages. Amen. Glory be to Jesus Christ. Glory forever.